We've heard about the four V's in here, and a couple observations about the four V's, the volume, velocity, variety, and value. The first is, you know, we were kind of stuck at the beginning with the stuff on the left, the volume and the velocity of the data coming in. And I'd have to say that that was really kind of a computer science engineering physics problem, right? And we've come a long ways in a short period of time to really get our handle on that. And that has unlocked a whole opportunity for us to be able to do things we've never been able to do because we've been able to solve sort of this physics problem. You know, this was originally the Hadoop map reduce architecture. Now the Spark architecture on Hadoop has really enabled us. So those are enabling technologies. But what's interesting is as you go from left to right, you actually are going from to the more hard things, but of the higher value stuff. So really the value on the far right is the ultimate goal, right? We don't do big data just to do big data. We do big data because we're trying to do something with it. And so I say the term big data in and of itself is incomplete. What we really are saying there is big data analytics. So really kind of want to focus more on the right side of that. And so I'll talk a little bit about the kind of the practical struggles that we're having today and how people are overcoming those. And without overcoming them, we're never really going to get to where we need to get in there. So these are observations and breakthroughs around those observations in the field of big data. So really, it's kind of interesting with this, you know, a lot of this isn't new. The analytics part is still a struggle. Big data, small data, medium data, just getting a lot of, and we've seen some of the examples earlier today, and it was really almost irrespective of the data set size. It's what does this mean? What is the value? And what's most important is that we're not really looking at single data sets. We tend to talk about and put our mind around a single data set at first, but really the value is the derivation of several different data sets combined together. And to do that, you really have to have that integration thing figured out. And what organizations are struggling with is this is not usually a greenfield environment. They're not really just coming from nothing into existence and they're going to create their whole data empire out of nothing. They have existing systems. So big data is an integration across different data sets, and those data sets are sometimes big data and sometimes not big data. And so until they do that, you're not going anywhere because you don't have the enriched, the curated information that you need to do the next part of this, which is the analytics. Now, on the analytics side, we're still not there yet either, right? We're still struggling with tools that make it easy for the people that we call the analyst to be able to rapidly experiment on the data. So today it is very typical to find somebody to come up with, you know, a data scientist will come up with an idea, we'll get a programmer to go out there, and he'll have to, you know, program through all the algorithms, and they'll get it back over and they'll say, what do you think? And they'll say, I think my algorithm's wrong. There's something messed up here. Let's rinse and repeat. And that's not really where we want to be. Lucy talked about it, the agility, the speed to get to value is really, really the goal in there. So I'll talk about some of the things, some observations and breakthroughs we're seeing in there. The other part of this is security. Security, and I include the privacy aspect of this inside of there. It's always the last thing to be added, especially in the public sector space. It's extremely important. Handling an anonymity of data, the privacy of citizens, healthcare information. There's a lot of sensitivity to it, and we're still struggling with that. So I'll talk about some observations and best practices of where people have been able to figure that out. And again, without doing these three things, we're never going to get to where we really want to get in regards to big data. So what's the approach here to these barriers? Well, integration, what I'm going to put forward there is really thinking about it as a system of systems and combining different elements. And you have to think about it, and you have to be able to think about it as a very large system working down into sub-assemblies, and be able to identify and understand those transfer relationships. I'll put a couple of those up there in front of you. From an analytics perspective, there's a couple of things that we need to be able to do. One is we need to be able to make it as simple to do analytics as it is to move a computer mouse, right? There cannot be advanced training required for people to be able to do this. The analytics have to be intuitive. And the other thing we have to do is we have to make it so that as we try to get into this variety of data, that we have some standard, predictable, deterministic way to ensure that how we're accessing the data and the results that we are getting are in fact valid, good results. And we'll talk about why that's a challenge today. From a security perspective, the approach is, as you see here, policy-driven enforcements, but the idea is, so that what I mean by that is they're declarative, they're not programmatic, right? There's a way that I can declare what people's authorizations are and how that maps to data access, and that the enforcement of that is consistent and transparent. Consistent and transparent, so that no matter how you're getting to the data, you know that the right security is being applied, and that it doesn't interfere with the analytical process or the way to derive the analytical process. So those are sort of the answers to the end. In fact, you can go at this point. I've kind of given away the whole rest of it. There we go. We're getting there. There will be a break here in just a couple of minutes. My colleague Bruce Edwards is going to elaborate more on this slide here, but I thought it a nice way to kind of draw the landscape. On the left, you see the raw data inputs here that have really been enabled through what we talk about with big data processing. So I'll put the physics part in sort of big data processing, and that's the ingestion of all kinds of data. What's interesting I find about this is the Internet of Things. Internet of Things, kind of funny. So let's put sensors on the entire everything, like every atom of anything that could be there, and collect it. And so we're doing that. And what's the intent of that? We're not sure, is the answer. We're not really sure what we're going to get. We have some examples when that has been done of extreme value that has been derived from that, but I'm not sure that we knew that going into it. In other words, we put the sensors on there and started transmitting sort of in this optimistic hope that someday this will be compiled with something else that will provide meaningful data to somebody else. And that's how you start to go from the left in across the chasm there. So you get a reservoir. The innovation is happening below the surface there. You see that line there, innovation execution in that data lab. Lucy talked a lot about what that is. And that's this part I was just describing. We're not really sure, but we've got some really stellar examples of how people have been either able to drive better quality service to citizens, drive down costs, or just quite frankly, create innovation because of their creative application to fusing different data sets in a certain way and being able to then later identify something of meaningful value of that that drives their execution in there. So kind of a rinse and repeat cycle, but this is kind of a nice way of doing it. And again, I want to stress the point that it's the data combination here isn't just, you know, this raw and structured data that we're thinking that are coming from these sensors. It's the combination of everything, every data type from every data source that we can reasonably get to put together and assimilate, which, again, is in and of itself a hard problem. Now, this is a classic example of something that we're seeing as we go across. The highest value, I believe, again, is from the combination of different types of data sets. And the different types of data sets tend to be represented in different types of formats. And therefore, we tend to store them in the most optimal way for whatever that format is. So we may have a geospatial database for capturing geospatial data and doing mapping and routing data. We may have document-centered databases for capturing unstructured document text. We may have our transactional systems of things that we know. We may even have like our sentiment analysis and so forth and so on. And the problem is, as we think of the question that will derive us the most value, we realize that we have to grab data, bits and pieces and subsets across this chasm. And this is the challenge, right? Because it's siloed in all of those things. So by definition, it comes in a very fragmented form. So we've got to figure out now, what's the best way to approach this reality to really get to the big data value inside of there? Okay, so And going at this, here's the observation of what I've noticed is these interfaces tend to have, in many cases, a proprietary kind of programmatic interface. So that's the first thing we try and understand is there a way that we can create an interface layer that is standards-based or as close to a standard-based kind of thing, even as a de facto standard to some extent. But there's some way that I know that I don't have to have an expert spun up on every different type of thing to be able to ask the question from this type of thing. So we need an interface layer. And then in the big thing in that represents sort of the data and the processing, the specific processing on those is in this big rectangle in the center. And here's what we've learned from big data. Big data works because of the highly parallelized, highly distributed architecture on which it resided, right? And so you can't just take these things and say they're running on a single machine and you're relying on that as one of your input vectors to get to where you're at, because it's not a highly reliable, highly parallelized thing. It won't scale. If it goes down, the whole thing goes out the window. And so there's this attribute that describes what these things on there is an absolute necessity as we go across. So you need that attribute across all of these different types of analytics and data. And then there's another part down here in the data layer that people are struggling with is big data means big storage, lots of storage. So what are we trying to do to accomplish that? Well, we got to look at these kinds of technologies, compression, deduplication, oftentimes the encryption, the security will live down at that storage tier as well. And all that has to happen sort of underneath the covers inside of there. So this is really a way of taking the best that we know in the data layer, in the interface layer, and in the processing layer, and saying this is how we need to approach this from an infrastructure and architectural capability. Okay, so here's what we're observing as far as how people are sort of making much closer forward progress on it. Now, there's an emphasis. So we talked about, you've heard a lot about structured data and unstructured data. It's not about the data. It's about the access to the data. So it's about structured data access. And one of the things that we're seeing is, hey, you know this thing that was called structured query language we created a long time ago? What was it created to do? Well, it was created to be able to have a deterministic way to ask a question over a set of data and get an answer that is reliable and consistent. And there's, in fact, a way to validate, given a data set and a question, that your answer is that your processing engine is in compliance because your data set will be exactly what we say it should be. And that's extremely important. When you don't have a structured data access that has consistency in it, you don't get the determinism of the process of being able to ensure that the questions you're asking are going to give you the same answers every time. And it may not just be because of the system as much as it is how a person would interface with it or would write a program to extract the data. Yeah, we've seen this many times in people performing geospatial functions, for example, and trying to compute if a region's inside of another region and overlaps, and you get two people say, yes, it is, and no, it isn't, and what you realize is that programmatically, one of them made an error. And they made an error because there was no structured data access way at the time that they were using that said, well, if we just ask the same question, we should get exactly the same answer. So structured query language today is the direction that people are going, but they're not doing it necessarily over structured data. So it's structured data access over data, period. Structured data, unstructured data, all together at the same time. And the way they implement that is through basically underneath the covers. So you come in through a standard, predictable, deterministic interface layer, and then it transparently casts those down into those different systems to pull the answers back up, aggregate them together, and provide you the consistency and the answers that you want. Another example that big data has taught us, the big data revolution, it's not just what you do, it's how you do it that makes the difference. And I talked about this a minute ago, but what I'm saying in this is as people have gone out to implement this concept, okay, Dave, we get it. We'll have a SQL layer, and then we'll go out across all these different things, and we'll get the data. That implementation can quickly fail if you're not marrying it back up with what I said about the parallelization, highly distribution of the processing, minimizing data movements, that is, pushing the processing to the data, not bringing the data up into a centralized processing hub. We have to maintain these concepts. These are timeless concepts that are there about how to scale these systems out. So the point here, not just what you do, but how you do it, that will allow you to actually achieve your goal. Okay, so let me talk a little bit more about integration. You know, this is an ugly part, but it is absolutely critical that's out there today. And we see people that just can't go hardly anywhere because they're dealing with a lot of the issues that you see here about it. And some of this is data movement. Some of this is data transformation. Some of this is data cleansing and quality. So I'll talk a little bit about this. And it's dirty and it's ugly, but the point I want to make is that we've been doing this for a long time already, albeit maybe more on structured data than unstructured. But nevertheless, what we've learned and the tools that we've developed to do this are invaluable, and you have to do this. If you're just looking at one data set and it's consistent all the time, that's great. But that's not really what we're talking about here. We're talking about, let's say I take a JSON document, two different JSON documents, keys and values, and you just say, there is no way, there's probably, it would be a remarkable coincidence that these are coming from two different sources, but let's say there's an overlap or there's something in both of these sources that we want to combine, that these things would automatically be in the same key and value format. So we have to do some sort of transposition, some sort of transformation into what that data is to join these, to even be able to ask the questions. Data quality is another thing. We talk about the sparsity of the data. We're trying to, is there value in the data? And we start to look at the data and we see fields and sometimes they're filled in and sometimes they're not filled in. And we can't make a determination if we're counting something if it turns out that only 15% of the data set has a value in the field. So we have to be able to inspect what these are and then decide what to do about them. You know, simple example, for example, let's say we're counting citizen data and we're looking, there's a gender field that comes in here. And you know, it may be blank, it may have an M, it may have an F, it may say male, it may say female, it may have an O. And so those are several examples. And now you say, well, I want to count all of them by, let's say female. We're trying to deliver some service that are derived from females. Well, I have to be able to go through that easily and figure out how do I clean that data so that it can be useful. And this is still a thing. So point is, this sort of systems approach represented here, these tools exist, the expertise exists. We have to incorporate that into our big data thinking for us to get to where we want to go. Nothing better than a 2x2 broad chart, is it? I mean, the whole world comes down into this. I thought it was kind of an interesting a way to think about this next part, which is, you know, how we go from variety into value. If you start at the upper, so what do we have here? We have questions that we want to ask and the data that will provide the answers, sort of, supply and demand kind of thing. So the demand is the question, the supply is the data here. And so known knowns means that we have a question we want to be able to ask, and we have the data that supports the answer to it. And that's, you know, typical reporting kinds of things. And that's, you're done when you're there. This is great. I know what I need to ask, and I know how to get the answer. I have the data that provides it. The next easiest is to go to the upper right here is I know the question I want to ask, but I don't have the data. But I know what kind of data I need to answer the question, so what do? I go out and I get the data, and that moves me from here back over here, okay? The lower left down here, the Discover and Explore, this is the money quadrant. This is where we are today. A lot of people, when they're talking about big data and analytics, this is what they're talking about. What do you mean by that? And some people call this the September 12th quadrant, right? It is, we had the data, we just didn't know what question to ask about it. And so the Internet of Things, right, is, well, let's get all the data. And then we'll figure out what to ask on the data. And that'll move us from there up to there. And there's some challenges to that. I'm going to talk about how people are overcoming what those are. Now, you're probably saying, well, Dave, you left out the unknown unknowns, which is always an interesting thing. And it is. It says, I don't even know what I would ask and if the data were therefore would support it at all. It's sort of the point of singularity where time begins and physics breaks down, and it is represented here for completeness. Okay, so how do we go from this mishmash of raw data, now almost sort of the Internet of Things, and just different data sets that I'm able to get access to, assuming the world is your oyster of data. You can get any data in the world, and you want to create the next big thing, and you get data, and it's just stuff. It's just stuff. And a lot of times, you don't even know what the stuff is. And you're trying to get from that into something that's meaningful, that drives that. And this is the interesting breakthrough that's going on today, which is the ability for us to program into our analytic engines to understand the shape of the data automatically for us, figure out based on the cardinality of the data types and formats, what is this kind of data, and then to automatically render it into a format that makes sense for, get this, a human being. Yes, that's what's doing this creative analytical thing. And we're stuck because when humans look at all of that raw data stuff, and it's like, I don't know what this is. I mean, I think that's a phone number, but I'm not really sure if it's a phone number, and I don't know what else to do with that. And an idea would be able, you take that data, you load it into the system, it goes through and says, these are phone numbers. This first part is an area code. Those area codes have a geolocation to them. I'm going to put this stuff onto a map automatically for you to be able to understand, you know, if there's something about this that has some geospatial thing that was derived out of the data automatically, right? So it's us being able to drive this sort of machine learning. And some of this, by the way, is somewhat heuristical as well, right? So it has to have an adaptive algorithm that allows itself to say that I don't understand why, but for some reason, when I render this data in three different formats, users always pick the first format. And therefore, that's the most popular. I'm going to make that the most selected format. And the machine doesn't have to understand really why only that happens, but it is an aid to the user to be able to more quickly discover, explore the information. The other part about this is really the ease of this. I spent a lot of time in graduate school on a human-computer user interface. I just find it fascinating, the psychological aspect of trying to get machines into computers and computers into minds into computers and computers into minds in there. And there's just a great amount of work that still needs to be done in this area. And I believe it is, without trying to offend any brilliant minds here, that the analysts think at a higher level and don't really necessarily understand what engineers might be thinking and how they think, and statistical analytic PhDs think about numbers and data. And the problem is that the folks, the engineers and developers down here, represent the information in a way that makes sense to them, but it doesn't make sense to these other folks who just kind of think differently. And that's a breakdown. That's an impedance in the process. It just doesn't work. And so what we want to be able to do is give the capability to the analyst to be able to transform and visualize without necessarily having to disturb or require the PhDs and the programmers every single time they're trying to flip something around. Another example of this, of how important it is to have data in the right visualization format. is outliers and clustering, which very interesting things. Today we look at data sets, and often what we're really trying to understand is what is the relationship between these data sets? In other words, which data sets have influence over other data sets and which ones are the most important? So you need to be able to have a graph analytics capability. I think clustering is an important visualization aspect to it. And what's important is we need to ensure that what we're producing does not require advanced training for the user who's consuming the information we're producing. In other words, they look at a line, this is bad, this is good. That doesn't require training. See, this is important stuff. You look at an outliers, it's easy to find the outliers visually. Like, it happens like this. It's almost after the fact that we realize that. So what we have to be able to do is take the data and pivot it into multiple different visualizations so that, because we don't know ahead of time. We only know after we know. So the trick is to be able to pivot the data into different visualizations, not necessarily be smart enough to anticipate which one is the right one inside there. Okay, so I'll end on a couple of aspects on security. Ideally, this is what we're trying to do with security. What I'm showing here, this sort of matrix version of data, is just sort of a way for where people can logically separate data. And whether you think about them as attributes, or whether you think about them as columns, or whether you think about them of instantiations or records or rows, is really inconsequential to what I'm, it's really the point I'm trying to make here is no matter what you want to be able to do to slice the data from a security and privacy perspective, the system needs to be able to support what that is. So sometimes that's wipe out, all of the names of the firms that were used in the census gathering. Just blank that whole thing out. Sometimes we get into, and that could be social security numbers, for example, we can get into demographics of subsetting inside of these things, or even inside of the data cells themselves, being able to redact out either the entire thing or parts of the data themselves. Now, why is this important? Because many times the data we're using is real data about real people in real situations. And there's laws governing the use of that data that will prevent or allow us to do this if we can get this correctly. So kind of where we are today, I alluded to this, this is declarative security consistently on in a transparent way. And it's the ability to do the basics in security. We know what the basics are, but we haven't quite incorporated them fully. We're working really hard on that. What are the basics? Identification and authentication of users. If I don't know who you are, I can't do security on anonymity. I have to know who you are. The access control, primarily through encryptions and ways to understand when to decrypt based on the authorizations of those people. And lastly, the auditing, the auditability to ensure that everything is going, that we're in compliance, we're not breaking any regulations, and nobody's personal information or whatever else has been disclosed inside of there. If you take that and you marry it with an example, with the structured data access through let's say SQL, if I come in through a single layer, in this case, a structured query language layer, that transparently federates, goes out, retrieves all the data. When it comes back, before it's presented back, now I have the opportunity to apply all of my security policies, all at the same time, consistently, all in the same place, through a structured interface. So, thrilling conclusion, I'll put up here with the following comments. Presenters, when you put a slide up with words on them, your audience will read the words. And when people are reading, they can't actually listen to what you're saying while they're reading it. So you can fill the time with something like what I'm doing right now until such time as they're finished reading it, and you can say, here are the following points on there. It's not big data, it's big data analytics. We're not just doing big data to do big data, we're doing it to derive a value from inside of that. In some ways, this has exacerbated the challenge we've always had inside of analytics itself. We've learned a lot about integration, how to do it. We need to leverage these tools. We need to leverage what we've learned about architectures, leverage what we've learned about interfaces. And lastly, the big data value is determined by that framework. What I mean by that is We have to have intelligent access with the security in place over that eclectic data, right? And represent it back in a way that is visually intuitive, and we can help that, we can drive this forward at an exponential rate through that self-discovery mechanism, self-discovered analytics, where our competing systems are able to pre-synthesize and understand that data and represent it back in a more meaningful way. Thank you so much for your time.